you're here. Come on in. Do you know what this broom and this beer have in common? They're both made with sorghum. If this surprises you, you're not alone. Sorghum is not as widely used and consumed here in the US as it is in other parts of the world, but its growing potential is very exciting. Don't worry, I'll fill you in. Cheers. Few people in the US eat sorghum, where it's mainly grown for livestock feed, but it's gaining popularity here with brewers and distillers, mainly in whiskey and gluten-free beer production. It's also being explored as a biofuel, but in other countries, in Africa, sorghum is not only a key food staple for people and animals, it's also an important and versatile building material. Here at Colorado State University's sorghum demo plot, we can catch a glimpse of just how diverse of a crop it is.
So in the demonstration plots, we have some that show the different grain color as well as the gloom color, which you can have a very bright red pink grain or a very pure white grain. And there's some lines that have huge seeds, some that are very tiny, some that have a twin seed. And so there's quite a variety even within just the seeds. And then we have my favorite section. We have 10 lines that really show a breadth of usage in sorghum. So we have some biomass sorghums, we have sweet sorghums, we have broom corn, we have a couple other just grain sorghums in that too, as well as one accession green leaf.
All these different types of sorghum and their traits are used for different purposes in plant breeding. In the 1960s, Texas A&M and the USDA created the landmark Sorghum Conversion Program to take tropical African sorghums and adapt them to temperate climates like we have here in the US. In this case, adapting these lines means removing photoperiod sensitivity and establishing a dwarfed height that allows combine harvesting.
Sorghum's origins are in northeastern Africa, and so because Africa aligns pretty well with the equator there, you think about how sorghum grows in this 12-hour of daylight, 12-hour of nighttime scheme, and therefore making it a short day plant. If you think about what we have here in the US, where sorghum is grown, it's in the summer upwards of 15, 16, even 17 hours of daylight per day. And that would render these tropical sorghums unable to flower. Sorghum's not cold tolerant, and so by the time you'd get it to flower, you probably would have your crop killed off by frost before you're even able to get a harvestable yield. So it's really important to have these correctly timed flowering times, and so that you're not, losing your crop to the irregularity of timing.
Sorghums in Africa can also grow to be around 12 feet tall, but because most sorghum in the US is harvested with a combine, it can't be higher than 5 feet or the machine won't be able to cut it.
The flowering time and the height are the two traits that really kicked off this effort. The way that they achieved this was by taking these tropical African lines and crossing them with a variety that's already suited to temperate production.
This resulted in new varieties that retained much of their original diversity and were also able to grow and produce in the US. With this new genetically diverse baseline, the program began to explore traits like drought tolerance and disease resistance, and it's still going strong today.
So having this already adapted, accessible germplasm that's available to have as a reactionary tool to any sort of evolving, migrating, changing stresses that are brought on as climate changes, as water resources become more scarce. It's really valuable to be able to take action more quickly in these breeding efforts and ultimately just ensure a more secure food system in sorghum in this way. There is this huge amount of diversity to be tapped into. Understanding what is out there is really important for trait exploration and for trait discovery.
As the climate gets drier and hotter, we'll need alternatives to crops that use a lot of water and resources. It's valuable to know that such incredible diversity exists in sorghum, and what its untapped potential could mean for the future.